Okay, so you saw the title. In this video, I'm going to be going through each decade from the 2010s to the 1980s, and we're going to look at one MVP from each decade that may not have deserved the MVP award. So I'm just going to lay out all the facts, and it'll be up to you to decide if another person should have won the MVP instead. Alright, so we're going to start right away with the 2010s, and specifically the 2014 NFL season. And in this season, JJ Watt, he just had a season that looks like it was curious. Rated through Madden. Let me start this off by throwing you some basic stats. As a guy who alternated between defensive end and defensive tackle, JJ Watt led all D linemen with 59 tackles, he led in tackles for loss with 29, 10 pass deflections, and sacks with 20 and a half. He also messed around and won the only unanimous defensive player of the year in NFL history, and on top of all of that, the GOAT himself finished the season with 3 catches for 3 yards and 3 touchdowns. To remind you, this is a goddamn defensive tackle. So, what happened during the actual season to result in him not winning the MVP? Well, to no fault of his own, JJ Watt just so happened to play for the Houston Texans. So, yeah. But after a 2013 season where the Texans were literally the worst team in football, they decided to shake things up a bit and bring in... Oh no. But somehow, things actually started off going well, as the Texans went 3-1, beating 3 teams that were competing for the rights to, Jameis Winston? And then, of course, the Texans' flaws came to the surface as the season prolonged. Their biggest issue is they just weren't good enough as a team to carry the weight of a true MVP candidate. As, although their offense had some talent with a Pro Bowl running back in Arian Foster and a deadly wide receiver duo of a young DeAndre Hopkins and the pile of wrinkled flesh that was 33-year-old Andre Johnson, they just didn't win games. And meanwhile, another MVP candidate did. Aaron Charles Rodgers went on to win the 2014 MVP that year, and he won it relatively convincingly, getting 31 first place votes compared to JJ's 13. The Packers also won 12 games, which was tied for the most in the NFL that year, winning their division in the process. And Aaron Rodgers had an incredible season, throwing for 4,381 yards, 38 touchdowns, only 5 interceptions, with a season-long quarterback rating of 112.2. So, although Aaron Rodgers was incredible, this is where the actual value of the MVP gets murky, as between Watt and Rodgers, there is a serious debate that could be made either way as to who is more valuable to their respective team. On one hand, JJ Watt was easily the best defensive player in the entire NFL, but only 2 defenders had ever won the MVP before, and it's a fact that it is way more difficult to affect a football game as a defensive tackle than as a, you know, literal quarterback. Also, I know the MVP is strictly a regular season award, but Aaron Rodgers and the Packers would go on to have the worst playoff meltdown, second worst playoff meltdown of the decade, losing to the Seahawks in just degrading fashion. Shout out Brandon Bostic. And unlike Aaron Rodgers, JJ Watt did not lose in the playoffs at all. Well, he didn't make the playoffs, but... You get the point. Now, to introduce the next MVP, we're gonna go to the 2000s, and let's take a look at the year 2009 in particular, where in this season, there was a 4-man race for the MVP between Brett Favre, Drew Brees, Peyton Manning, and Philip Rivers. And in the end, Peyton Manning had an all-time great season, winning the MVP with 39.5 first-place votes. But like I said, there was 3 other real contenders for this MVP, so how can I possibly narrow this race down to one candidate who should have won the award? Well, I did, and although Philip Rivers and Brett Favre would have won the MVP in probably about, 93% of other seasons, Drew Brees had an unprecedented talent of timing his best seasons perfectly when someone else had their own historic season. So, yeah, in the 2009 season, Drew Brees went absolutely berserk, but so did Peyton Manning. So, here are their stats side by side. Peyton Manning didn't lose a single game in the games he finished and started, while Drew Brees only lost 2 games all year long. Besides that, looking at all the stats together, Drew Brees had Peyton Manning beat in just about every major statistical category. So what the hell happened during the actual season? Well, if we go even before the season, the Saints had just come off an alright year, breaking even at 8-8. But there was a huge problem with the 2008 Saints, and that was Drew Brees was almost quite literally the entire team. He was the only Pro Bowler on the whole team, and the defense was even worse than the offense, ranking in at 26th overall. So going into 2009, Drew Brees was fully prepared to pull off a carry job of the century, and that's exactly what he did for the most part. Drew Brees had the Saints winning their first 11 games in a row, all without a single rusher even close to 1,000 yards, and a defense that rose from 26th all the way to, 20th. Yeah, Drew Brees could never catch a break on defense. So even with little elite talent on offense, Drew Brees didn't care, as he spread the ball around evenly, throwing a touchdown to 10 different receivers, while only throwing the ball on 53% of the Saints' possessions. Anyway, still, his lackluster weapons at his disposal and subpar defense was nowhere near enough to stop this bloodthirsty man from taking the one seed in the NFC for his own. And once again, of course, the playoffs don't matter for the MVP award, but it can help give some context to certain regular season stats. And in said playoffs, the two best quarterbacks in the league blew every team out of the water on the way to their inevitable Super Bowl collision. Peyton Manning versus Drew Brees, who would prove themselves as perhaps the best player in the entire NFL. Huh, would you look at that. After a rough first half, the Saints were able to beat Peyton Manning the Colts off of huge plays from their special teams and defense of all things, while Drew Brees put up 288 yards and 2 touchdowns, winning the Super Bowl MVP. In the end, the Saints won their first ever Super Bowl, and Peyton Manning went home empty-handed. Well, kind of. So, for the 1990s, let's go way back to the year 1990, and I gotta say, I had a tough time finding a so-called fraudulent MVP from this decade. So I decided to go with two players that I believe deserve the MVP more than the winner, and that's Warren Moon and Randall Cunningham over Joe Montana. Well, in the year 1990, Joe Montana walked away with the award for the second year in a row, and this time it was his last year with the 49ers. The issue is that in his 1989 campaign, Joe's numbers were night and day better than 1990, and I mean, come on, the man threw 8 more interceptions in 1990 than 89. And what's come to be a theme, if voters simply can't decide who deserves the MVP, all the voters group together and say, ah, f*** it, let's go best player on the best team. Or second best, third best, fine, the quarterback on the best team. I mean, look, the 49ers literally had 2 of the top 5 defensive player of the year candidates. They were absolutely loaded. And meanwhile, Randall Cunningham and Warren Moon were just playing at another level, as with severely less talented teams around them, you can see that both of their individual numbers completely eclipse Montana, as Moon dunked on him with yards, touchdowns, and yards per game, while Cunningham damn near did the same, on top of the fact that he was basically a prehistoric Lamar Jackson, running for, at the time, the second most rushing yards by a quarterback in a season ever. And somehow, if you need more proof that these two quarterbacks were robbed, they both finished higher than Joe Montana in the Offensive Player of the Year voting, with Warren Moon running away with the award. But that year, the 49ers went on to win a league-high 14 games with only 2 losses on their way to the one seed in the NFC. Meanwhile, both the Eagles and Oilers lagged behind just a little bit, only winning 9 and 10 games respectively. And how'd the playoffs go? Well, for Warren Moon, he actually injured his thumb in a game before the playoffs started, so he never got a chance to show his full talent, and the Bengals throttled the Oilers without him. But for Randall Cunningham, Joe Montana at least got out of the first playoff game, and then, yeah. So just like that, every single MVP contender season all went down in a fatal car wreck, and in Montana's case, that would be the last game he would ever play for the 49ers, as he broke, like, 82 bones when he took this whopper to the back. But like I said, the playoffs still didn't affect the MVP race at all, and purely based on the regular season alone, Montana, at the very least, had better seasons in the past. Okay. So, for the last few MVPs, at best, it was a bit of a toss-up whether someone actually got robbed of an MVP or not. But in the 1982 season, Dan Fouts, the Hall of Fame quarterback for the Chargers, threw for a league-high 2,883 yards, 17 touchdowns, 11 interceptions, and a quarterback rating of 93.3, second highest in the league, all in a strike-shortened season where there were only 9 games played. So this means that if Fouts would have kept that pace up for the rest of the season. The man would have thrown for about 5,125 yards, which would have been, at the time, by far the best season a quarterback had ever had. Wow, I mean, it must have taken some season sculpted by the Greek gods to take down Dan Fouts' incredible season. A kicker won the MVP that season. A kicker. Mark Mosley committed one of the most egregious crimes in human history, robbing Dan Fouts of a clear MVP and his pride in the process. You know, let's take a deeper look at this MVP season from Washington's most valuable player, Mark Mosley, because there's gotta be at least some logic on his side, right? Alright, well, even before the 1982 season began, Washington's Hall of Fame coach Joe Gibbs told Mark Mosley to not even bother to show up to training camp, and to be honest, he didn't deserve to be on the team. As to that point, his career had been going on since 1970, only making one Pro Bowl a few years back, and in his last season in 1981, he had a rough campaign, missing 11 field goals and 4 PATs, both near the top of the league. So after being utterly disrespected, Mark Mosley defied everyone and showed up to camp anyways, and thus the Mark Mosley Revenge Tour would finally begin. As the season began, Mosley made his first 6 field goals, including multiple game winners. Okay, so the man was beginning to build some kind of narrative around him. Then he did it again, and again, and just kept hitting game winners over and over again. So Mark Mosley finished the 1982 season, making 95% of his field goals, converting 20 out of 21 attempts, literally missing more extra points than field goals. And the thing was, in this shortened 82 season, Washington went on to win a league-best 8 games. So, in a twisted fashion, the voters voted for the best player on the best team, and the award ended up going to a kicker. But still, this award had no business going to Mosley, as Dan Fouts was literally the conductor on just, you know, one of the most efficient offenses of all time, that by every statistical measurement was by far the best offense in the league. So what do you think? Which of these players was the victim of the biggest MVP robbery in NFL history? And anyways, if you enjoyed this video, then subscribe, because I got a lot of videos on the channel just like this one. And if you enjoyed this video, then watch this video right here on the hardest Super Bowl ever won. It's pretty good, trust me. Anyways, until next time.